Hello, Malty Muggles and Mudbloods. Ralfy here with Ralfy Review 635. And thank you to Vartan for the malt mention, introducing a sort of St. Patrick's Day special whisky review of an Irish whisky. You'll probably have noticed that I've taken the opportunity to commence this vlog by making a contemporary statement as regards to St. Patrick's Day. Yes. And this follows on from a very recent conversation I had with an Irish friend of mine who's just across the water, just to the west of Dublin. And she is absolutely sick of St. Patrick's Day. In particular, just to narrow it down a little bit, the tat, the tack, the forced craic, the additional drunkenness, in particular by non-Irish people. And she's a little bit aggrieved about the fact that the references one makes to Ireland as a country tends to be stuck in a cliche, rather like shortbread and kilts is a bit of a cliche for Scotland. But in Ireland's case, an awful lot of contemporary culture is overlooked, bypassed and simply ignored because of the dominance of this St. Patrick's Day style cliches. Right, now I don't know if you agree with me or not, but I have assured my friend, hello Sylvia, that I would amend the situation by starting off the St. Patrick's Day special with a little bit of tat, then clearing it off into a cardboard box where it can remain until it's needed for later. And I shall replace it with some good quality Irish traditional stuff. There we go. Redbreast, 21-year-old, pure pot still Irish whiskey. This is what I'm going to review. A little bit of Irish calibre, Irish quality, Irish identity, Irish culture, and it all comes in the glass from the bottle. And we're not going to get pished, we're not going to get drunk, there will be no forced crack, whatever you call it, no applied humour, none of that. We're just going to spend a little bit of time nosing and tasting something of particularly good quality that comes from Ireland. And I suggest, in fact, I'll go further, maltmates, I highly recommend that you really recalibrate, that's what it is, your St. Patrick's Day points of reference. Remove the tat, remove the tack, and actually explore a wee bit of the fascinating historic culture that you will find in Ireland. You know, read up about Newgrange, for example, a very good place to start, or the stunning beauty of the West Coast, or the ancient Celtic cultures that that really defines the modern identity of Ireland. And in fact, these ancient traces are reflected in the Irish flag. And St. Patrick wasn't a Roman Catholic. He was a Celtic saint. There's a difference, small mates. Oh, there's a big, big difference. And you need to understand your history and go way, way back in time to really know what it's all about. We'll only go back to 21 years with this little fella here. This is Redbreast, 21-year-old, bottled at 46%, triple distilled, pure pot still Irish whiskey. And it's part of a range including 12-year-old, there's a 12-year-old cask strength, and there's a 15-year-old. Personally, I prefer the 12-year-old because Irish pot still whiskey, as made by Middleton Distillery down the south of Ireland, it has this certain distinctive, definitive character which you do not find anywhere else. And that is why I enjoy it so much. The pot still character is really well defined in Jameson's Crested 10, which I believe is no longer available at the moment. It's a shame. But it represents really well in the Redbreast range. You also get Green Spot, but that's a little bit different. Nose. There's a lovely fresh apple, like apple juice, immediately hits you. Barley sugar. Mild toffee. Some beautiful aromatic green notes. A little bit of mint. Very slight anise. Angelica, most definitely. Gentian, a little bit of that. Wintergreen, yes. These classic green associate notes you get with pure pot still whiskey. I'll explain why that is shortly. It's beautifully intact for 21 years. One of the concerns when I bought this bottle was that there would be too much cask influence, because it's something I've noticed that when there's too much overt oak influence in a pot still whiskey, it actually just flattens out the spirit-driven integrity and identity of what it is, which is why I generally prefer pot still whiskey younger rather than older. 8 years old is a great age for a pot still whiskey. Sweet, slightly sherried arrival. Then the aromatic, the mint, the slightly dark cocoa notes kick into the development. Quite a powerful kick for 46% volume. In fact, I'm going to add another spoonful of water to help this little fella open up. I poured this whiskey 20 minutes ago before I started this review for the simple reason Irish whiskey is just like Scotch whiskey, in that for every year in the cask, give it a minute in the glass, just to settle down, aerate, oxidise a little bit, and open up and deliver best results. A good substantial development here. A little bit of cola in there, a little bit of nuttiness, some marzipan. Those green notes are still quite a prominent feature, but they're slightly more matured, so that some of the fresh mint's got a little sultana edge to it. Some of the nuttiness seems to be surrounding the wintergreen, perhaps the angelica notes. So there's this additional complexity due to the aging in the cask, which has been subtly done to the extent that you're keeping and just rounding off the original pot still, younger pot still moments, with a little bit of seasoned maturity, which maintains the integrity of the whole event. There would be nothing worse than a big dominant sherry cask that all you're tasting is sherry and a bit of mint. It just would destroy this whiskey. But this has been very, very nicely blended together. A drop of water, more toffee, fudge, a little bit of sharp lemon peel, lime leaf, a little bit of mild ginger syrup, as in the ginger you get in jars with sugar syrup. Ginger syrup note, definitely. Quite a complex range of mints. There's some spearmint, apple mint, definitely. And a little bit of some kind of sharper vanilla mint, I think you would call it. A dry vanilla mint note. The development isn't particularly long for a 21-year-old whiskey, to be honest. But it doesn't really matter, because we're really tasting a style of pot still I certainly haven't encountered before. A delicate, long-lived pot still, which still displays youthful vitality. And in the finish, it comes through as a little bit of chamomile, a little bit of jasmine, a little bitter note, as in bitter green, matcha green tea. There's that vanilla oil in the finish. And that tanginess, that slight little sherbet tang that you get from traditional pot still whiskies. Really lovely stuff. I'm going to have another smell, another taste, and then I'm going to give you an Irish malt mark. When I say malt, it's malt grain. In other words, it's malted barley and unmalted barley. And the unmalted barley is a grain, but there again, malted barley is a grain that's not, that has been malted. I should perhaps just call it Irish malt and have done with it. The arrival. It's taking on a whole new elegance. A bit like a, reminds me, I'm actually reminiscent of Savannah rum from the Pacific. Absolutely delightful. In fact, I will take even, I'm going to add a bit more water yet. There's a little bit of heat in there that initially I don't notice it, but as time goes on, as I'm kind of teasing out the different smells and flavours in this, it doesn't really go away and it's annoying me slightly. And I'm wondering what it is. It's something I've not really encountered before. And I suspect it's the fact that you're really looking at a large industrial process production. And I feel it in my pish, malt mates. Yes, if you need an interpreter for that, be my guest. I just feel it in my pish that small craft distilleries in Ireland are, when they do it, when they get round to doing it, are going to produce the best pot still Irish whiskey going. But options are really very restricted at the moment, more or less to Midleton. I hope that situation changes. All credit to Midleton for a good, for Jameson's, essentially, for creating a decent and palatable veteran pure pot still whiskey. But I think Ireland's got a lot more to offer than this in the future, and I look forward to making encounters with it, whether it be St. Patrick's Day or not St. Patrick's Day. Frankly, I don't care, what mates. I'll be in the mood as and when the mood takes me. There's quite a slightly flinty edge to this. It doesn't detract from the experience, but it really defines it. It defines it as a competent, but not a great pot still. Marks. I'm going to give this 88 out of 100, and that is an Irish malt grain mark. I've mentioned this in the past, but I'm going to mention it again because it's really quite interesting. And there's a bit of a story attached to it. In case you haven't encountered pot still whiskey, it goes back to the Napoleonic times when Ireland, as usual, was having a really rough time from England. That's the way, that's history for you. And a lot of it involved, as usual, taxes. And there was the dreaded malt tax. Now, it affected England, Scotland, Ireland and Wales. And it was basically the usual excuse, we need lots and lots of money so we can have wars so that the rich people can get richer. Sound familiar? So basically, the malt tax was introduced because the government knew that everybody everywhere, no matter their status, class, wealth or poverty, would be consuming malt in the production of beer and spirits. And so to get round the draconian malt taxes, some Irish distillers started combining unmalted barley with all malted barley. Now, malted barley is the germination process that turns the carbohydrate starches in the grain, right, into yeast digestible sugars in order to facilitate fermentation, right? Okay. Whereas unmalted barley It's not allowed to germinate. It's simply as is, the grain intact, with its starch content intact, not broken down into sugars due to enzymes. It's part of the germination process. And the flavour is, it's a lot greener. It's less sweet, more savoury, basically. So the distillers would add a proportion of this unmalted barley, knowing that if they double distilled their whiskey, they wouldn't get much yield out of the unmalted barley. However, due to the provenance of triple distillation, which a lot of Irish distillers used to do to make a cleaner, fresher, brighter, smoother, more palatable whiskey, hence the reason the E went into the name whiskey for Irish whiskey, because essentially it meant there was less chance of confusion with the rough, hot stuff that was coming out of Scotland. There you go. It happened. Sometimes it still does. Oops, controversial. Move on, move on. We've got the flow, Ralphie. We've got the flow. Malt mates are listening. And so you've got this combination of malted and unmalted barley going together into the ferment, the washback for fermentation, thereafter into the stills, where due to the triple distillation, there was some partial increase in the yield. But importantly, you got this greater definition of a brand new flavour that you do not get from malted barley alone. And this is what's called pure pot still style. And it's the green notes, the fresh aromatic vegetal fruit, papaya, slight guava, greengage, gooseberry. Think of any green fruit. Gooseberry is a great example. So is kiwi fruit. You'll find these notes cropping up either boldly or subliminally or delicately in the pot still character of Irish whiskey. And it really stands out there in its own. It's quite distinctive. And it really surprises me that more distilleries are not doing it, because it is an intrinsic part of contemporary Irish whiskey identity, because it's got real tangible roots in the past. There you go. Now you know, just sharing. So that's the... I've always been a fan of pot still style of whiskey when I first encountered it many, many years ago in Greenspot, when it was a more matured whiskey and there was a lot less demand for it. It's the way it goes. There's a tremendous freshness for a 21-year-old whiskey, but in a sense, this kind of balanced maturity going hand in hand, it makes for a new experience. It's a really excellent version of a modern Irish whiskey, frankly. I'm Ralphie and I'm recommending it. Enough said. Well, how will we conclude this show? Well, I suggest if you're going to buy one bottle, they're relatively expensive, but if you're a real whiskey geek, you will find this pretty worthwhile. Nice, attractive presentation box. Probably best getting two bottles, because the trend in collecting Irish whiskey seems to be for older Irish whiskies with age statements above 20 years old. For the simple reason, there's very few of them around, very few indeed, because traditionally the habit and the culture of Irish whiskey has always been for young, frequently non-age statement stuff. So there's a growing in that. When you're looking at the collector's market for Irish whiskey, it tends to be distillery-only bottlings. Take hint, Irish distillers. If you don't have your distillery-only bottling, you need to get it sorted right now. It doesn't matter whether it's whiskey or gin or vodka. We know you're producing a whole range of do-good stuff. Absolutely. Anyway, that's me for my St. Patrick's Day special. I won't reintroduce the tat out the cardboard box. We're done and dusted with that. I'm Ralphie. I've completed my whiskey review. I'm happy. Hope you're happy. And I hope you'll return again, having clicked in my ads. And if you've not subscribed, please do. Plug, plug. And I'll be on to whiskey review. What the hell is it? 636, which will be... which will be, interestingly, following on from a traditional pot still Irish whiskey, it will be a local barley Scotch whiskey from somewhere very near Ireland, you see, because, and a very simple reason, if you're looking for a Scottish equivalent or point of reference to an Irish pot still or pure pot still whiskey, the nearest you're going to get is your local barley versions from some small craft orientated distilleries, right? Few spoilers in there, but I don't want to give you too much away yet. You'll have to come back again to see what Ralphie, that's me, ralfy.com, here in the Manx Bothy, middle of the Irish Sea, lovely place to be. Even when it's a bit stormy, we don't care. Show goes on, you know. And enjoy your St. Patrick's Day. Give him his full title, Patrick. You know, please do the guy a favour. Don't bore the Irish people. Don't laugh too loud. And don't laugh at stuff that isn't genuinely funny, because it kind of spoils the atmosphere. Okay? If in doubt, get a genuine Irish person who's actually up for a good time and not a misery guts to kind of get the party started, so to speak. And don't put green dye in your beer, please. Please just do not put green dye in your beer or the vodka or the gin or the whiskey, because frankly, it sucks. Just saying.